morning. It's the first Sunday of Lent. It's also St. David's Day, and if you were observant to the music that was being played as you came in, the first piece was prelude by Vaughan Williams on the hymn tune Ros y Medre, which we're going to sing later in the service. And then Ed played for us Dafydd y Garreg Wen, a Welsh poet. How about that, eh? Let's begin by singing This Day God Gives Me Strength of High Heaven. Telling the story of Jesus' betrayal and suffering and death. We do not do this to be morbid, but because in the story of Jesus' death and resurrection, God is revealed. In the amazing transformation of death into life, in endings transformed into beginnings, and in dead ends that become the source of new possibilities. This is the sacred center of our faith, the truth made manifest in Jesus Christ. God is in each and every one of us, quietly transforming us and the world. In his pain and suffering, Jesus speaks to every pain and loss you have endured and offers you the promise of transformation. It's an old story, but it still has the power to reveal, to heal, and to redeem. Jesus is at the heart of our faith, in the depths of our souls. He is waiting for us, inviting us to leave ordinary time and follow along with him on the journey that brought him to the cross. Listen in silence. Jesus is calling you. And as we extinguish this light, we acknowledge the darkness and pain and injustice in the world. Wait for the Lord.
So, if you have been raised with Christ, seek the things that are above, where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God. Set your minds on things that are above, not on things that are on earth. For you have died, and your life is hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is your life, is revealed, then you also will be revealed with him in glory. Put to death, therefore, whatever in you is earthly: fornication, impurity, passion, evil desire, and greed, which is idolatry. On account of these, the wrath of God is coming to those who are disobedient. These are the ways you also once followed when you were living that life. But now you must get rid of all such things: anger, wrath, malice, slander, and abusive language from your mouth. Do not lie to one another, seeing that you have stripped off the old self with its practices and have clothed yourself with a new self, which is being renewed in knowledge according to the image of its creator. In that renewal, there is no longer Greek and Jew, circumcised and uncircumcised, barbarian, Scythian, slave and free, but Christ is all and in all. As God's chosen ones, holy and beloved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, meekness, and patience. Bear with one another, and if anyone has a complaint against another, forgive each other, just as the Lord has forgiven you, so that you must also forgive. Above all, clothe yourselves with love, love which binds everything together in perfect harmony. And let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, to which indeed you were called in the one body. And be thankful. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly. Teach and admonish one another in all wisdom, and with gratitude in your hearts, sing psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs to God. And whatever you do, in word or deed, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. Devote yourselves to prayer, keeping alert in it with thanksgiving. At the same time, pray for us as well, that God will open to us a door for the word, that we may declare the mystery of Christ, for which I am in prison, so that I may reveal it clearly, as I should. Conduct yourselves wisely towards outsiders, making the most of the time. Let your speech always be gracious, seasoned with salt, so that you may know how you ought to answer everyone.
Long reading, but any word is worth it. We're going to say the psalm together. I will read the ordinary type, if you read the words in bold. Out of the depths I cry to you, O Lord. Lord, hear my voice. Let your ears be attentive to the voice of my supplications. If you, O Lord, should mark iniquities, Lord, who could stand it? There is forgiveness for you, so that you may be healed. I wait for the Lord. My soul waits, and in his hope, in his word, I hope.
My soul waits for the Lord. More than those who watch in the morning. More than those who watch in the morning.
O Israel, hope in the Lord. For with the Lord there is steadfast love, and with him is great power to redeem.
Thank you.
Suddenly, angels waited on him. Jesus is in the wilderness for 40 days. He's surrounded by desert, wind, sandstorms. He struggles for the lack of food, and he's on his own, battling with the elements, with his own thoughts, and with the devil. And only when it is over do the angels bother to turn up. Some of you, and this may be a generational thing, some of you may remember the Vaughan and Wise show on television. At the end of every episode, a woman would come forward and take the bow. She hadn't appeared through the entire show, and then Vaughan and Wise come to take the bow, this lady rushes in and makes this fantastic curtain call. There's also a wonderful classic novel, Petals of Blood, by the Kenyan author Ngugi Wa Thiong'o. It tells of Kenya after independence, and those people who had fought for independence, had fought against colonialism, are impoverished and live difficult lives, while those who quickly took power at the end of it all were those who hadn't fought at all. They turned up at the last minute and claimed the prize. I once went to an event which was organised by a group of young people, all of whom who had applied for asylum in this country. And like many others, they were waiting for the Home Office to answer their claim. When we arrived, we were told to queue. And then occasionally some people were let in, while the rest of us had to queue, and then occasionally we were let in bit by bit. And when we got in, they had another few tricks to play on us. One young man came up to me and said, "Would you just hold this for me?" It was a box, I think it was held a box. "So I'll be back in a minute." Of course, he didn't come back. They were just trying to make the point of how frustrating their lives were, waiting, 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 just for the news to come from the Home Office that they were able to get on with their lives again. Waiting, whether it is for something good or something bad, can be frustrating. Whatever it is we are hoping for may come or it may not. We may take the prize or see it grasped from us by others. And this, as we've already recognised, is Lent. A season to pay special attention to our spiritual well-being, to prayer, to study, and to pay attention to each other. Lent should be a challenging time. It's a time for us to think, to change our perceptions, to see the world with fresh eyes. And we know that Jesus was tempted by the devil. But it was not the devil who took Jesus into the wilderness. He was led there by the Holy Spirit. And if we are to be guided into Lent by the Spirit, then we need to be open to finding hope in despair, light in darkness, and to being tested. Jesus' time of introspection was a calling from God. It was a response to God's call, even though it was tough. Our journey into the wilderness needs to be spirit led. We go into the wilderness with Christ. Even we take time simply to be with him. And there's a very fashionable form of meditation called mindfulness, which comes from Buddhist practice. There are lots of courses, books, and counsel available to you, mostly at a price. But strangely, we're less familiar with the Christian spiritual discipline of watchfulness, and you can have it here for free. The Bible is littered with injunctions to be watchful, to be alert, to wait on the Lord. We wait for a bus, we wait for our holidays to arrive, we wait for the rain to stop, and like those young people waiting for papers, which would allow them to get on with their lives, we might be waiting for something very important. Watching out for God is not just a feeling of anticipation. It is a conscious discipline, an essential part of discipleship. To be watchful is to pay attention to yourself, to your Christian practice, and to the world around you. Today is also St. David's Day, and on his deathbed, St. David said these words to his brother monks: "Be joyful and keep your faith and your creed, and do the little things that you've seen me do and heard about. And as for me, I will walk the path that our fathers have trod before you." Do the little things. It asks us to pay attention to the things that we can do to live the Christian life. So many things hinder our ability to grow in faith. We are anxious, overwhelmed, overworked sometimes, and locked into negative patterns of behaviour in our relationships. Watchfulness is to examine our own behaviour. Are we being negative rather than hopeful? Are we putting our stress onto others? Are we so focused on the things that are going wrong that we don't see the good? Are we super critical of our own achievements, our work, our abilities? Last week a group of us looked at the first chapter of Genesis, and we read that when God created the world, he looked at it and saw that it was good. Watchfulness is to look and see what is good. And I don't think I'm being naive in saying that looking at the world and seeing that it is good is the first and the most essential thing in turning around the abuse being done to the planet. It's to look and to see what is good. We first have to realise that the planet is worth saving. So our watchfulness means that we don't just walk down the street, but we look around us. We look out of our windows at the birds and the squirrels, and we look for insects and see how nature fights back against the concrete and the pollution. To be watchful is to be aware of all the things for which we should be grateful. And these are strange times. All the terrible things that have been predicted, but we may have been rather sceptical about, are happening. Extreme weather, a pandemic, far-right politics becoming mainstream. We live in a country that is in transition, and it is far from clear what the direction is that we are taking. Our watchfulness is to look for signs. Do we see more people sleeping on the streets? Do we become aware of more people being more and more hard up? Do we notice our own money seem to be worth less than previously? Do we see more and more ostentatious wealth, waste, unnecessary consumption? Is there more or is there less single-use plastic? And when we look around us, how do we think the people in our neighbourhood? Are they relaxed or stressed? Busy or kicking their heels? Are the people who serve us in shops and cafes treated well or not? Do we treat them as functionaries or people? Does that apply to the people we speak to on the telephone? Or does that depend on how long we wait for the call to be answered? And what about our church as well? Are we coming closer as a fellowship? Are we more prayerful, better informed, more energetic in our commitment to the kingdom? Those of us who came to see the film The Street a couple of weeks ago saw a film about Hoxton Street. And afterwards was a very enjoyable Q&A with the film's director. He was an absolute genius at being what is called a participant observer. Therefore, while he was filming an old woman who had been resident in the area throughout our lives, he also was caring for her. He was looking at her, calling in and speaking to her. This is watchfulness. It is looking inward, being conscious of what you're doing, being aware of the impact you're having on other people, and doing the right thing, and looking out to pay attention to others. Jesus in the wilderness has the opportunity to watch for a different future for himself. He is tempted, tested. And the devil has three ways of putting Jesus to the test. He takes advantage of Jesus' hunger to see if Jesus will use his power to turn stones into bread. He tries to tempt Jesus by linking him to the powerful, to demonstrate his power by asking the angels to protect him from harm. And then he tempts Jesus with political power. And in rejecting each of these temptations, Jesus turns them around. He watches, he observes, he engages. And then in his ministry, he draws upon the experience in a positive way. He refused to turn stones into bread, but then fed a multitude of people with just 2 loaves and 5 fishes. He refuses the power given to him by God, either to protect himself or to impress. Yet when tied to a cross, he withstands the taunts and the ridicules of the passers-by. He refuses political power, yet offers the humblest of his followers a place in the kingdom of God. This is watchfulness in action. My soul waits for the Lord, says the psalmist, more than watches for the morning. Our task this Lent is to be watchers for the morning that is to come. It's Easter Day, the most blessed morning of them all. It is then that the angels appear to roll away the stone at the tomb. They're not like the woman who claimed the applause at the end of the Morgan Wise show, or politicians who climb to power on the backs of others. And we hope that our young people receive the news they want, their wilderness encounter with them. For us, our time in the wilderness is accompanied by the promise that angels will come and minister to us. Angels will roll the stone away. Our faith has to be that through prayerful watching, we will emerge on Easter Sunday more aware, more committed, more compassionate, and more faithful in our discipleship and love of Jesus Christ.
Song, shelter me in. shadow of your love, for we are your righteousness. If we die to ourselves and live through your death, we shall be born again to be blessed in your love.
Prayer. The times we are living through are confusing, disturbing, anxiety creating. Prayer for our families everywhere, their health and happiness. We will pray for Pat's cousin Terry, who's being diagnosed with cancer, and for his wife. And we will pray for Liz, Philip and Kate and the family, the loss of Liz's mother. And we will also pray for Judy, for the arrest, the disturbances in Santiago. Let's pray. For our church, as we begin this season, each person who worships here, for their well-being, their growth in faith and love, for our ministry of service to others, and our calling to proclaim the good news of Jesus in a world which so desperately needs to hear it. We pray for those in special need, especially we pray for Liz and Philip and Kate and the family in Australia. And we pray for Pat's cousin Terry, who has been diagnosed with cancer. We pray for those who experience pain and injustice, for the people of Chile and all caught up in civil conflict, for those who are tortured, for those who are innocent victims of abuse and discrimination, for those who are sick or bereaved. Times we are living through are confusing, disturbing, anxiety creation. So we pray for families everywhere, their health and their happiness. Lord, you are alone in the desert. Be with us in our aloneness. May we be ever watchful over those who need our love and compassion. And may we be ever alert the struggles for justice in our world today. In your name we pray. Amen. Sing again. The love of God comes close and stands an open and an opportunity to take jewelry.
Thank you.
Then we move to sit first row, third row, and fifth row. So what I'm going to do now is, since we've got this coronavirus, it may be a bit unwise to share the piece in the usual way of shaking hands, especially thinking about people who might be a little bit unwell. So I suggest that we share the piece by waving to each other. How's that? Yes, it's a good idea. Okay, so if you move to first row, third row, and fifth row, and wave to each other as you do it. Okay? Very well this week. You have your sheets with you. I should have said that. Do you have your sheets with you? Yep. Take it. Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give God thanks and praise. We bring our gratitude to God for life itself, bequeathed to us in love, for the wonder of creation and its intricate web of dependency, for God's work in history, bringing freedom and dignity wherever it is denied, giving strength, power and wisdom to all who work for justice. You have made your love manifest in generation upon generation, the love which is open to us in this our day. At the beginning of our Lenten season, we enter into the holiness of God's presence, sensing God's Spirit and the power of the risen Christ. We remember that Jesus was tempted in the wilderness, but he healed and taught, and remained faithful to the cross and the tomb. And we remember that on the night before he died for us, our Saviour Jesus Christ took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke it, gave it to his friends and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." As supper was ended, Jesus took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you and for all, for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink this, do it in remembrance of me." Remembering now the suffering and death and proclaiming the resurrection and ascension of Jesus, our Redeemer, we bring you before you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit. Be for your people the body and blood of Christ. And we pray for all gathered here in this chapel, that our church will be renewed by the power of the Holy Spirit, through Christ and with Christ and in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit. To you be honor, glory, and praise forever and ever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. We who are many are one body. We all share in one body.
Thank you.
God of abundance, you have fed us with the bread of life and the cup of salvation. You have united us in Christ and one another, and you have made us one with all your people in heaven and on earth. Now send us forth in the power of your Spirit, that we may proclaim your redeeming love to the world, and continue forever in the visible life of Christ our Savior. Announcements. Sacred Justice Circle meets on Tuesday at 7 o'clock in the church office. Culture Cafe is 11 to 2 on Wednesday. Just come and have some lunch or dinner with us. And then next Sunday, the Union Chapel Singers will be taking part in the service. Your homework for the week. Next week, our prayers will be for the pain and injury done to the earth and its ecosystems. So if you just pay attention to the injury done to the earth and its ecosystems, and then next week when you arrive, you can just put in one of these little cards at the back and just make note of your watchful observations and we'll pray for that. And also, our Lenten reflections are going out day by day. The same thing. You just want to encourage people to fill them in and read them. And so if you have had an email from Daisy Ann, if you have, just have a word with her and Agatha, and you receive the reflections each day by email. If you haven't been receiving them, also let us know to make sure that you're on the list. So we close by singing. We close by singing, Guide Me, O Thou Great Jehovah, great hymn from the start of Lent. Guide me, O Thou Great Redeemer, pilgrim through this barren land. kindle of God, the love of God, and the grace of God. Strengthen you to be Christ's hands and heart in this world. In the name of the Holy Trinity.